Greetings everybody around the world, wherever you may be. You're very welcome to this edition of Capricorn Radio. This is your host, James Swagger, and for the next hour, we'll be getting into some fascinating topics. But before I do, you can check out the links for the live shows at capricornradio.com. We also have a new members area there. You can check out the full MP3 archive at capricornmembers.com. I'm introducing a special lifetime membership fee for Capricorn members. This will entitle you to Capricorn radio shows and Capricorn TV interviews. To sign up for the members area, head over to capricornmembers.com or equally follow the links on capricornradio.com. And today I'm going to be talking to three very special guests. These three guys are stars of the Ancient Aliens History Channel TV show. And each one is a formidable researcher in their own right. I'm going to be talking to Andrew Collins. I'm a longtime fan of Andrew's work since I read the Cygnus Mystery. And we're going to be talking to a returning guest as well, Hugh Newman, he had a previous episode with Earth Grids, his book on Earth Grids. Fascinating little book it is. And we also have a very special returning guest. Brien has been on a few times, and I love what Brien does. And I love tracking what Brien does, traveling around the world. And igniting passion and research in other people with his collection of tours, photographs, videos, and other documentary stuff. So without further ado, let's bring on our guest for today. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Capricorn Radio.
Well, hi.
Hi there.
Wow. Okay, we've got three voices there. Andrew, I guess we'll start with you first. If we can get a little bio off you, Andrew, who you are as an author, what you like to research, what you've done in the past, and you know, what got you into this field of research?
Writer, lecturer, explorer, and the author of probably around 14 books on the origins of civilization and other ancient mysteries and more modern mysteries. I've been in this field for far too many years. And I'm full-time at it, writing all the time, researching. My main area of focus at the moment is the remarkable discoveries at Gobekli Tepe in southeast Turkey. But also, to my credit, I discovered a whole underground cave system at Giza, which nobody knew anything about, which was within the shadow of the Great Pyramid. So that's something that made me world-famous around the world. But there's plenty more, but that will do for the moment.
Well, thank you, Andrew, and you're very humble as well, I have to say. I mean, since you wrote the Cygnus Mystery, you have been on a personal journey that's been fascinating to watch. And, you know, you are like a modern day Indiana Jones, as they say. And, you know, I commend you on everything you've done so far. And if people haven't got a copy of the Cygnus Mystery, it still is tangible and readable today as when it first came out. Hugh, let's tell us a little bit about you. You've what's I would call an Earth Mysteries investigator, if that would be true?
I think that could be classed as true, yes, certainly. I mean, I'm very much into the megalithic sites. That's why we kind of created the Megalithomania conferences back in 2006, which actually Andrew was a speaker there talking about the Cygnus Mystery before it came out. But I've really been researching ancient sites all around the world. I've become a kind of avid traveller, really want to see things close up for myself and sense the energies. And, you know, I first went to Gobekli Tepe with Andrew last year on a tour we organised with Graham Hancock as well. And that, to me, as Andrew, you know, clearly points out, and this forthcoming book and everything, that is really like the game changer, the sort of paradigm shifter of all the ancient megalithic sites around the planet. So we're delighted to be going back there with Brien this year.
Oh, thank you, Hugh. And again, you're very modest, and you've been chipping away at the megalithic monuments, and you've pioneered a whole genre of research from others, and you've collected everybody at the Megalithomania conference as well. And let's maybe bring Brien on. Brien, can we get a little bio off you? You're no stranger to Capricorn Radio, Brien.
No, it's always a pleasure to be back. Thank you, James. I guess I would call myself a student of indigenous cultures growing up on the west coast of Canada. I was a professional totem pole carver for a number of years. Then I moved to Hawaii, where I explored the Polynesian culture and their origins for a long time. now I'm based in and actually live in Peru because I'm so fascinated with the amazing cultures of Peru and Bolivia, as well as Egypt and other parts of the world. I haven't been to Turkey, and that's why I'm fascinated to have the opportunity to go with two brilliant men who we are talking to today. It's an honor to meet Andrew, and Hugh and I have quite a extensive history now and ongoing adventures together.
Wow, thank you, Brian, and hopefully I'm going to solicit another show off you with L.A. Marzulli. I caught your Red Ice interview with L.A. Marzulli, and he's been on the cards for a show, so hopefully I'm maybe going to get you guys onto the show to talk about that soon. But I think what you do, Brian's great. I'd love to see what you think of Gobekli Tepe. I guess you have a collection of different perspectives and viewpoints of all these different megalithic sites around the world. I guess the thing to point out to the audience at this point is we're going to talk about Gobekli Tepe today. You guys are going on a tour in May 26th, I believe, and maybe Andrew can tell us something about the tour, what's involved, and how, you know, give us a detailed breakdown of the tour, what you guys are going to do. Andrew's been researching in Turkey for a long time now, and Armenia, I believe.
Yes, yeah. I mean, Gobekli Tepe is probably one of the most exciting discoveries in archaeology for a good many years. The easy way to describe it would be, if you can think of Stonehenge, you know, with its trithalons and standing stones, and transport that onto a mountaintop in southeast Turkey, then times it by 20, and then have all the stones carved with beautiful creatures of the natural world, and then bury it beneath a huge body of earth, that is essentially what Gobekli Tepe is, and that's what the archaeologists are trying to explore at the moment and have been since the mid-1990s. And the important thing about it is that it was constructed as much as 10,000 years ago, possibly even up to 12,000 years ago, at a time which was just after the end of the last ice age, and a time when there wasn't farming, there wasn't animal domestication, and in theory, everybody was hunters, you know, with survival on their minds all the time and feeding their families and things like that. You know, there was no such thing as megalithic architecture or monumental architecture, and yet suddenly, for some reason, all the people in southeast Anatolia, you know, modern day Turkey, suddenly came together to create these incredible megalithic structures, with some of the stones towering as tall as 18 and a half feet, measuring as much as 50 tons apiece. You know, where did this come from? What motivated it? What made these people give up their lifestyles as hunters and build this stuff? I mean, that's the big enigma. And obviously, it's captivating everybody's interest around the world within the ancient mysteries subject. And a lot of people want to see this place. I mean, they've been to Stonehenge. They've been to Giza to see the pyramids. They may have been to Peru and places like this. And now they want to go to Gobekli Tepe because this is almost like the origins of everything. This is like going back to the source. And the fact that the biblical Garden of Eden is in the same general region is another thing. It's like, you know, supposedly we're told that this is where humanity started. You know, so if you want the answers, this is where you've got to go back to.
Wow, thank you, Andrew. That's a beautiful description. You've really, I guess you've really shown the mystery of it there. You know, this is a time frame where, you know, we're not supposed to be thinking about these structures. This wasn't supposed to be in existence. And
exactly.
Yeah.
You know, and even the archaeologists accept that megalithic architecture on this level really doesn't begin until the structures like Avebury in southern England or Karnak in Brittany, France, mm-hmm. or obviously the Great Pyramids themselves. Mm-hmm. You know, this was the time of megalithic architecture. And in theory, all of this should not have been happening several thousand years earlier. And it's turned on all our traditional values to do with the origins of civilization on their heads. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, it's now a case of how does all this fit into the so-called Neolithic revolution that supposedly began with the introduction of agriculture, animal domestication, And what's becoming clear is all of that came as a result of megalithic architecture like Gobekli Tepe. In other words, you know, all the people that were there creating these monuments, managing these monuments, visiting them, you know, had to be fed. So they had to change their style of living from hunter-gathering, because very quickly they were exhausting the local, you know, supplies of game and, you know, the animals that were obviously naturally in that area, because there were so many people there. They needed to think again. And obviously, you know, the inventiveness brought about the idea that we should follow up these ideas that have been kicking around for thousands of years, called agriculture, you know, the use of wheat and rye and barley, and domesticate them, because that can feed everybody. You know, I mean, I know that's simplifying it, but in a way, that's exactly what happened.
For sure. You know, I think that's a very key point, is that, you know, they always assumed that agriculture came first, and then because we had spare time,
We got into religious stuff,
but it's the other way around, Andrew.
It's the other way around. I mean, it was a prehistorian by the name of V. Gordon Child, who came out with the idea of the Neolithic Revolution. I think it was in the 1930s. And, you know, and the thing is that his idea was that the agriculture came first. This gave us plenty of time to sit down and ponder over life, the mysteries of the universe. And we started to create temples, and the temples needed an infrastructure, and that led to the beginning of civilization.
I think that's the biggest thing that the archaeologists are really struggling with this, Andrew, because, you know, they've carbon dated this thing to, what, 10,000 BC?
Just below, yeah. I mean, it's around 9,000 to 9,500 BC, but it could easily have started in 10,000 BC.
Yeah, and they're struggling with this concept of religion came first and then the agriculture. I mean, they can't get their heads around it.
Well, they are, but they've got to. You know, I mean, this is not some kind of, you know, left field speculation here. This has to be the mainstream now. You know, we have to start trying to understand why, at the tail end of the last ice age, the hunters, and I call them hunters because in theory there was nobody else around. You know, I mean, we can talk in terms of lost civilizations, but as far as what we know and the evidence that's presented to us generally from archaeology, everybody was either hunters or gatherers or foragers. You know, they would live in temporary accommodation. They would move around with the different game animals, like, you know, gazelles or reindeers if they're in the north, elk, things like this. And it was a seasonal lifestyle where they would spend a certain amount of time at one place before moving on, and then moving on and gradually making their way back. You know, this was how life was. The idea of creating massive, great structures, possibly 20 temples, hundreds and hundreds of standing stones, the quarrying, masonry, priests, management, all this sort of stuff. It just does not compute with our idea of what a hunter-gatherer should be doing. And yet they were doing this, and we need to know why they were doing this.
I'm going to jump on to Hugh next. Andrew, we're going to come back and get into some of the physical descriptions in a minute. Hugh, you've had a tour there with Graham Hancock last year, is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct. And Andrew as well.
Okay, so you three guys are there. Tell us about that tour, you. What happened? What you guys done? Because that must have been a real meeting of minds there, you.
That was quite a powerful experience, I've got to be honest with you. Just because it was the first time both me and Graham Hancock had seen sort of Gobekli Tepe and most of the other sites there as well. I mean, just to point out, I mean, there are a few other sites in Quebec, in Turkey, that kind of absolutely blew my mind. They were obviously a lot younger, but one of the sites that I was very impressed with, and Graham was as well, and Andrew, was Alajuelik, which is not too far from Ankara, which is the modern capital. And there we have these huge polygonal walls, or puffy style polygonal walls, exactly like you would see in Peru, which kind of really stunned me. I mean, we'd seen photos of them, but actually to be there, they were pretty big. They were multi-ton blocks. There was also underground tunnels at this site with sort of corbelled roofing. There was very intricate carvings, even sort of nodules that kind of stick out of the rock, like keyboard buttons like you find at Peru, like Oyente Tambo and other places. And so there's quite a remarkable, there's quite a remarkable sites as well as Gobekli Tepe. I mean, another fascinating site, which I'm sure Andrew can expand on, is the underground cities around near Cappadocia and that general area. There's several of them, which again, they go back, you know, potentially 10,000 years, and no one knows why they were built. They're incredibly difficult to build. They go down multiple levels. They've been carved out of solid rock, and they have these rolling kind of disc doors that roll into place. Like they really wanted to keep someone out or possibly keep someone in. So there's a lot going on, in that part of the world. It's also Hattusas, which is, the sort of Hittite capital, although an earlier culture, the Hattians, potentially existed in that general area with Alleged Hoyak as well. But so we were pretty blown away by those sites as well. There's some very interesting stuff still there. And they're huge. They go on for miles. Obviously Gobekli Tepe is the one. That's the one, you know, everyone wants to see. Everyone's talking about. And the weirdest thing about it for me, is that so little of it you can actually see. It's tiny amount, you know, compared to what's there. Well, they've kind of done the ground penetrating radar and all this kind of stuff. So that kind of makes me really wonder what else is going to be discovered. But I think, you know, as one of the reasons we invited Brien is because when I was there, I saw so many similarities to Peru. Obviously, we have the polygonal walls at the much later sites, near Ankara. But Gobekli Tepe, all the relief carvings are strikingly similar to what we find in Peru and Bolivia, especially at, Cutimbo and Silistani, which are these kind of round tower, chulpa sites around the edge of Lake Titicaca, these funerary kind of towers, apparently. But also, even at Tiwanaku, there's evidence as well, and around Cusco with the serpent carving. So, it's just, there's too many similarities, I just wrote this article, for Ancient Origins, website, and it's been published on there recently, and also in New Dawn as well, a much more extended article. Covering all the different aspects. It really does seem like there were, you can't help but compare them. And you have to question, well, if Gobekli Tepe is definitely that old, then what about the sites in Peru? Because they've not really been dated properly. And there is evidence of direct, you know, contact between the Sumerian region and Peru with the famous Fuente Magna Bowl, mm-hmm. which has got Sumerian, inscriptions in it. And also that even you were talking about farming. I mean, even in Peru, in the highlands of Peru, it's known that, agriculture was being practiced, about 8,000, BC, with this guy called Tom Dillahay, who was doing research up there on squash seeds. And he found storage bins, he found evidence of cotton and peanut farming, mm-hmm. even irrigation canals and garden implements almost, going back, you know, 10,000 years from, you know, before now. So it's really, you know, Gobekli Tepe is like the smoking gun. It's kind of cracking open the whole dating of all the sites around the world. So I'm very personally excited to be going back there, delighted to be going with Andrew, and obviously with Brien's insights from Peru, it should be a most interesting trip.
Sure. Yeah, I had Rand Flemeth on the show, and he was talking about, he was obviously talking about earth crust displacement, but he was talking about the high altitude farming regions of the world, you know, from Turkey, Gobekli Tepe to Peru, they're all high altitude regions where, you know, you see all the crops getting developed. Yeah, I think the underground city you're talking about, Darinkuya, is that right? Darinkuya?
Yeah, that's one of the ones. Yeah, we're going to be looking at two of them when we go there in May, June. Wow. Yeah.
That's that one with the big round 20-ton doors that were keeping the people in. It's absolutely mind-blowing. Can you even guess what they were protecting themselves from? Or?
Oh, my God. There are ideas that have been popping out. Andrew may have some other information on this, but some people say it was to do with cometary debris, things like this. Mm-hmm. but really the you know, the jury's out, really, what they're there for. I don't know if Andrew's got any comments on that with through his extensive research.
I just, as an engineer, I think they're the most fascinating underground structures. They're so highly sophisticated engineered monuments now, you know, just it's mind-boggling. They had a sophisticated knowledge of construction. Coming on to Brien, I guess. Brien, are you with us?
Yes, sir.
Ah, okay. Brien, tell us about the carvings that you was talking about. He's led me into a question here.
Well, it is very true. There are two sites near Lake Titicaca, basically on the northwestern side in Peru. You have Silustani and also Cutimbo, but also there are other sites. And they have these large towers, some of them 20-plus feet high, which are made of, they're megalithic in general, as in made of large stones. In general, they're circular. They have an opening facing east, and so they a few of them do have carvings. In general, you have the same or a very specific theme. You have serpents, you have puma or other feline-like characters, and then you also have birds, often depictions of condors. And they were very; those three symbols were very important to the Inca. But in other sites, such as photographs that I've seen of Gobekli Tepe and other locations, again, you have a lot of feline characters and serpents, etc. And they're three-dimensional. They're actually, they project out from the stones. And so there are possible connections based on that sort of animal theme. But I think, you know, the most important thing, which both Hugh and Andrew have stressed, is the fact that it's been shown that Gobekli Tepe is of a specific time period. It is 10,000 to 12,000 years old. So the mystery is with a lot of the sites, such as in Peru and Bolivia, and even some in Egypt, they haven't been scientifically dated, and we've been depending, I think, far too heavily on conventional archaeology and anthropology to tell us ages, but what we need is we need a scientific measuring approach, and that's what has been able to be achieved at Gobekli Tepe, because it was buried on purpose. So my, I guess my input that I can give is to look for similarities in architectural style, etc., from the areas of Peru and Bolivia, which of course are still very mysterious. The Inca did not build everything that is in Peru. They did not build all of Machu Picchu or Ollantaytambo, etc. That's the opinion, and I stress opinion, of conventional archaeology. Some of the structures are far too complicated to have been achieved with by a Bronze Age culture such as the Inca. So it's the mysterious aspects of Turkey which really intrigue me. And from the videos and photos I've seen, Turkey is really an incredible location of ancient structures, which has not really been seen very often by the public in general. People think of ancient Greece or ancient Rome or ancient Egypt, but mm-hmm. Turkey, I think, is at least as rich as any of those places.
Oh, for sure. Hey, Brien, is there a link with the bird carvings? There's bird men relief or birds with the long beak. Is that any links at all?
It could be. Of course, at Tiwanaku, on the famous Gate of the Sun, there are depictions of transformational characters, of so-called bird men. And also, as Hugh knows, because he and I went to Easter Island together, that's a very heavy-duty theme there. We were there with Dr. Robert Schock, and Dr. Robert Schock has no problem in believing that some of the works on Easter Island could be 12,000 years old. So we're, you know, the fascinating thing is we're looking at amazing enigmas, which we are actually able to start unraveling now.
Yeah, for sure. Okay, coming back to you, Andrew, let's talk some of the physical description of Gobekli Tepe, its location, age, and kind of give us some of the size of the stones from the smallest to the biggest and the intricacies.
Well, as I say, work began there in 1995, and I mean, you've got to imagine that you're talking about working on the top of a mountain here, a limestone summit at the edge of the Taurus Mountains, and that you've got this huge grey earthen mound. It's about 300 metres in one direction by about 250 in the other. And basically, when the archaeologists got there, who were led by a German guy by the name of Dr. Klaus Schmidt, when they got there, they could see all over the surface fragments of carved stone. Plus, there were literally thousands and thousands of flint tools. And they were obviously sure that this related to something of a very ancient age, you know, obviously Neolithic. And yet the strange thing was, is that one initial survey team had been there in 1963 and had seen these fragments of carved stone and had actually dismissed them as part of a lost Byzantine cemetery no older than about 1500 years because of their sophistication. But Schmidt knew what he was looking at because he was already working on another, what they call pre-pottery, like a very early Neolithic site at a place called Navali Chori, about 20, 30 miles away. So he knew what he was looking at. And they began their excavations, you know, digging down into this mound, this tepe, which is what Gobekli Tepe means. I mean, Gobekli Tepe means the hill of the navel, basically, as in the stomach, because of its shape and possibly because of some very archaic beliefs and practices that were still held by the local Kurdish people. And they uncovered these four incredible structures almost immediately, which they've named enclosures A, B, C and D. And there were a number, possibly about another dozen or so smaller structures, possibly from a slightly later date. So the bigger structures, which have these rings of standing stones turned on edge, facing towards the centre, towards two massive, great monoliths. And all of these monoliths and standing stones have T-shaped tops, T-shaped terminations. So they look like hammers, basically, or hammer-headed stones. And many of them have carvings of them, creatures of the natural world. We're talking different birds, snakes, as Brien said, and we've got things like boars and foxes and lions and things like this, which are just cover them, basically. But the actual pillars themselves seem to be anthropomorphic in the sense that they represent some kind of human form. Some of them have bent arms on their wider faces, ending in hands that come round to the front, narrow edges that point and face towards the centre of the enclosures, towards these two great portal-like monoliths in the middle of them. And, you know, the interesting fact about it is that you know, it looks almost as if they've created some kind of gathering of these figures. You know, I mean, Schmidt says that it's almost like they're gathered for a dance. And this is very reflective of megalithic architecture in other parts of the world, many of which have folklore and legends to do with the fact that the stones are people turned to stone, because that's almost what the stones, the pillars at Gobekli Tepe are. They're almost like frozen great ancestors, maybe, or divine beings associated with whatever activities were happening at these monuments. Now, astronomically, they seem to be pointing towards the stars. Some people have suggested that they're facing the south towards Orion or Sirius, although my own work suggests that actually they focused towards the north, towards the Milky Way, the celestial pole, and in particular the constellation of Cygnus and its bright star Deneb, which marks a point on the Milky Way where there's a fork. It splits in two, and cultures around the world for many thousands of years have seen this as a point of entry and exit into some kind of sky world or upper world. It would have been a belief very much associated with shamanism. And there's a great amount of evidence that the people that were working here, you know, were almost certainly shamans, entering into altered states of consciousness, and traveling into otherworldly realms. And that the temples themselves, most of which are ovoid in shape, i.e. elliptical in shape, they're not circular, they're oval, may have represented almost like womb chambers, so that whoever was in them, you know, would achieve an altered state of consciousness and believe that they were traveling almost back to the source of life itself, somewhere that was considered to exist out in the stars.
Wow, fascinating, Andrew. You're describing something here that's so incredibly complex and sophisticated. It's mind-blowing.
Well, in a way, they're almost like stargates. I mean, you know, obviously we hear this term used a lot, but the central pillars at the middle, in the middle of the enclosures, which tower above everything else, almost certainly they represented some kind of gateway or doorway between which the shamans would stand to face towards wherever they were going. And in the two largest and oldest of the enclosures, which are C and D, which date back to about 9,000 to 9,500 BC, there were actually stones that were in the north-northwestern sections with large holes through them so that the shaman or whoever it was that stood between the central stones could actually gaze out on the distant horizon and watch the star Deneb, the brightest star in Cygnus, actually set. So maybe this was actually seen as like a marker when the gateway, the doorway into the sky world was open. And at that point, they could travel onto the Milky Way and, you know, encounter supernatural forms, power animals, great ancestors, divine beings, things like that. That is what I think was going on at Gobekli Tepe. And this is a pretty mainstream idea. I mean, Klaus Schmidt, who's written a book on the subject, has been out for several years now. He comes to very similar conclusions as well. Although obviously he's very, very cautious about connecting any of this with the stars or astronomical alignments. But to be honest, the fact that you've got megalithic structures all over the world that are aligned to either the sun, the moon, the planets or the stars, it's only natural that we should start looking for something like this at Gobekli Tepe.
Yeah, totally. You know, Andrew, I wonder, is there like an astrological theme to these animals? Were they maybe like a pre-zodiac?
Well, that's an interesting thing, which I have looked at. I mean, firstly, there is evidence that although the structures are now missing various of their stones, that certainly in the two largest structures, that the rings of stone numbered 12 originally. And obviously this is a very myth-laden number, one that would be associated with time and space and the movement of, you know, of the heavens in relationship to the earth. And in particular, the movement of the sun, you know, over the yearly course, and of course the moon and the 12/13 months of the moon. So there's obviously some kind of celestial component to these structures, that they are locked into some kind of time cycles in some way, which might also give us an idea why there are so many of them, because it does seem as if the star alignments, if they were genuine, would have gone out of kilter with the actual stars and their positioning on the horizon, probably in no more than 100 to 150 years, which would have necessitated either correcting the stones that were aligned to the stars as existed, or simply abandoning those temples and building new ones, you know, close by with new alignments. And, you know, this is something that would seem to have gone on possibly for 1500 years, from around 9500 BC down to about 8000 BC. When it would seem that the final structures, which by now were being built much smaller and much simpler, that eventually that the idea or the necessity to have these type of monuments went, and the final structures were covered over completely, and whoever it was that was responsible for the upkeep, the management of these places, just disappeared. And in a way, that's interesting because that also ties in with the beginning, really, of the Neolithic Revolution, mm-hmm. The whole spread of the revolution out into Europe, you know, down into the Levant, across into you know, Central Asia, even down into the Indus Valley, places like this, and quite possibly even into the New World. Obviously, around 8000 BC is a very important time frame for spread and the evolution of this, you know, the idea of agriculture and animal domestication. So in other words, what happened at Gobekli Tepe, and I'm not saying it's the only place in the world where this was happening, but what did happen there was almost like the catalyst, the trigger for almost the rise of civilization itself. It was the foundation point.
Wow. This is so incredibly important, this site. So incredibly important to mankind. This is like the new Giza.
It is, yeah, absolutely.
Andrew, you've got a book coming out. I want to mention that now while we get a chance before I forget. It's about Gobekli Tepe. It's coming out in May, and it's with Inner Traditions, who are favourites for me for bringing guests on the show.
It's called Gobekli Tepe, Genesis of the Gods. I mean, you know, just come on to andrewcollins.com and have a look. There's some details there. Or if you go on to any of the book ordering services and just type in Gobekli Tepe, it's the first thing that comes up. So, you know, it's very, very easy to spot out there. And that will tell you, you know, everything that you need to know about Gobekli Tepe, you know, why it was built, who built it, when, and its impact upon myth and legend and the origins of civilization, right the way through to the biblical myths of Eden, and the idea of the watchers of the Book of Enoch, to the Anunnaki of Sumerian myth and legend. It's everything. The whole lot is in that book.
Wow. Awesome. I can't wait to get hands on that, Andrew. You're going to come back and do a show on that for sure.
Certainly. Love to.
Yeah. Hugh, coming on to you next. Hugh, I take it you've seen the museum in San Lurfa?
Yeah, we've been there, yeah.
What do you think of that humanoid? I say humanoid very carefully, that humanoid figurine with no face.
It's pretty scary. I mean, that was found, that's almost contemporary with Gobekli Tepe, although it was found in Urfa, or Sandy Urfa. But the thing that gripped me about that, I mean, it's life size. It's pretty big. It's not like a giant or anything like that, but there's a few little anomalies on it which kind of grabbed my attention, because obviously, at Gobekli Tepe, on the sort of abstract statues, they're kind of supposed to be humanoid figures. They've got these hands coming down to the navel, which you get with the Urfa man statue in the museum. Obviously, you get that on the Easter Island Moai. You also get similar things in various other parts of the world. Even in Peru and Bolivia, you get some examples of pointing to the navel. So there's also one I spotted when I was in Costa Rica in the San Jose Museum, which looks very similar, you know, to the Urfa man, whereas, because not only has he got the sort of hands going to the navel and sort of gormless look on his face, like Urfa man, he's got like a stump. It's almost like the bottom of it is like a stump that is obviously placed somewhere and to stand upright, possibly, you know, at the entrance to a temple, possibly somewhere in the temple, almost like a guardian or a god of the temple. And you get exactly the same thing on the statue I saw in Costa Rica, which could suggest there are similarities. There's also relief carvings, very intricate relief carvings in Costa Rica by the same people who built or carved the stone spheres over there. So we have to question, is there more diffusion going on here than academia would like to mention? But also in that museum, which we do extensively visit on the tour, there's a very psychedelic totem stone pole kind of thing. The face is kind of missing off it, but it's got some very unusual carvings. One of them looks like almost like a face emerging from the stomach. It's almost like a baby coming up, a face emerging. You get a similar emerging kind of feet beings like pumas and other things at Cutimbo in Peru, but also in Costa Rica as well. There's a humanoid statue there where there's like three of them, sort of almost like Costa Rica, Gobekli Tepe, and Peru. There's too many similarities I've kind of been spotting. It could be coincidence, it could be something else, but also in the museum there, you get all these sort of strange kind of animal kind of little statues. There's the one of the almost lizard or feline type being with this. It's kind of like, it was actually one of the first things they discovered at Gobekli Tepe back in the 60s, I think. And it's like the top of a less old kind of pillar, like T-shaped pillar, with this kind of what looks like a lizard with the legs sort of popping upwards, kind of emerging relief carving from it. That, to me, when I saw that, I was like, oh my God, I'd seen one exactly like that. And I flipped through my photos, my film footage. And at Silistani, there's one almost exactly the same, like the same size, same style, same design. And it just makes you wonder, is that, how can that be a coincidence where you get all these minute details in different places? It kind of really resonates with me, that the idea that there was some kind of global culture which we have to kind of start taking on board. And exactly like what people like Graham Hancock and Robert Schock and Andrew and others have been saying all along. So it's amazing what you see when you go and look.
Yeah, what is it? Graham's been on the show. I never got a chance to talk to him about a few things because I was talking about War God, the fiction novel. But what's Graham reckon to the whole thing?
What, Gobekli Tepe in Turkey? I mean, he was obviously blown away by it. He spent some time there away from the tour as well. But I think it was as shocked as I was, I think. And he's going to be putting that out, and he's obviously in Magicians of the Gods, his follow up to Fingerprints of the Gods. So that should be quite exciting when that comes out. Obviously, Andrew's done the major research on the preliminary research, which is kind of, and that book's obviously going to be the one that is coming out very soon, which people are going to have to take notice of. Because Graham's take on it, it fits into his theory perfectly. It's just like Fingerprints of the Gods. He was claiming there was a post-Ice Age advanced civilization. Suddenly, Gobekli Tepe turns up. It's like, oh, there we go. Here's my proof. Thank you very much. So you have to kind of take into account that. And it's interesting that, it was first being excavated just after Fingerprints of the Gods initially came out. So it's almost like synchronizing. We have to question things now. Gobekli Tepe is utterly mind blowing. And it really, you can't help but question, if this highly advanced culture was doing this back then in Turkey, there must have been something, it must have developed into that, so where's the other evidence, or have we just not dated things properly? There's a lot more. I think this is going to be a sort of rewrite in the history books kind of paradigm shift the next few years, so it's very exciting to be a part of that.
Yeah, it's so funny, just looking back at the last 20 years, three of you guys will admit how alternative history has pretty much blossomed. It's just exploded. There's so many people writing books on alternative, so many different researchers from so many different fields. But I guess you what you're talking about there is the time this was discovered or investigated, it was about a year or two after Schock had the debate about redating the Sphinx. And, I think alternative history really needed something tangible. It came 2 years later with Gobekli Tepe. I know there's a lot of, there's been 20 years of research into it at the moment. But it just wasn't available at the time Schock was redating the Sphinx. And it's a shame because the Egyptologists were, where's the pottery shards? Where's this missing civilization? But, we have something to point to now.
Yeah, no, I totally agree. And I think it's extremely exciting. One of the other things Stonehenge, there's these huge wooden posts that were now, they're just white blobs in the car park, probably covered over with grass now. I think they've redone it all. But, and they go back to this kind of era as well, going back 10,000 years. So, there was something going on even at Stonehenge that long ago. And yet that's kind of brushed under the carpet. It's literally being covered up, literally, by a car park, and now probably grassland because they've changed it all up there. That there are clues popping up here and there. There's clear evidence of agriculture in Peru going back 10,000 years as well now. Clear evidence. It's been proven. It's been documented. It's been peer reviewed in scientific journals. So the evidence is there. It's just, even in the academic world, it's just a case. I think what blows my mind about Gobekli Tepe is the fact that these are like serious German archaeologists dating it. Yeah. It's not some random kind of student doing it or anything like that. This is serious stuff. And that kind of gives it the clout and it's really, really makes it hard to dismiss.
Yeah, I think if they could have redated that to any other period, they would have. But the fact that it's carbon dated to this epoch, it just upturns everything, and it's exciting, it's new, it's great, but I guess I'll save this question for Andrew about how little of it is uncovered, but fascinating. Do you think it ties into any earth grid theory? Is it at any geodetic location that's important?
Funnily enough, I did it when I did my Earth Grids book a few years ago. It was kind of a bit of fun, really. John Martin, my publisher and colleague, he's basically built an Earth Grid program for a computer. So we put in all the coordinates, based upon where the poles used to be, which is about 30 degrees off where they are now, like beyond 10,000, 12,000, 15,000 years ago, where, you know, in the Hudson Bay and things like that. So we fixed the poles and built the grid around it. And interestingly, Gobekli Tepe slipped into place onto that grid. So we don't know if that's just a beautiful little coincidence or if that's actually something meaningful. But, I think more research needs to be done, on the location, comparing it with other sites, which I'm working on, I will be working on shortly, because it's like in Peru, it's like, in Easter Island and other places, it's a naval site. It's like, like an Axis Mundi. It's like the belly center of, you know, that particular culture, which is echoes in other countries, especially Peru with Cusco and other places. It kind of means the navel of the world. And this is a tradition that goes back thousands of years in many different places, including Britain, Europe, many other places, possibly influenced, now we realize this, from, you know, places like Gobekli Tepe in Easter Island and other places. And so to me, I just sensed that there was certain traditions, you know, that are known about, could have, the origins could sort of shift back now to places like the Gobekli Tepe. So it's really kind of cracking open something, this, for multiple different levels. So it's going to be very interesting what else they discover there and how that fits into various theories.
Oh, thank you, Hugh. Coming on to you next, Brien, Hugh was talking about totems there. I can't help think about your totem carving, and you've obviously been a carver and an artist in that respect, and you've also been looking at quarries in the past. I'm guessing you want to go see the quarry, Brien. You want to look at the carvings. Is that going to be your area of research?
Actually, all of it, because the last megalithomania tour we had in Peru and Bolivia in November of last year, we had a number of dowsers with us. And these are people who are very serious about the subject, including Glenn Broughton. And so what they were able to pick up actually was a very clear energy band, which Hugh and I and others call the path of Viracocha. And so it's about 100 meters across and goes from the northwest to the southeast. And most of the megalithic sites we visited, such as Machu Picchu and Ollantaytambo and Silistani's close to it, but Tiwanaku, they're all more or less on this energy line. And so I'm very interested in what Hugh and others have to say about Gobekli Tepe's relationship to the worldwide grid. Gobekli Tepe is the hot archaeological site right now, the one that's really shattering the illusions of the idea that sophisticated civilization goes back 6,000 years. Clearly, it goes farther back than that. All of Andrew's brilliant work. And Turkey itself is a massive archaeological complex. So I think it's very important to visit many of these sites and especially look at the foundations, because that's where we see clearly the oldest works. And so in places such as Peru and Egypt, and other places, when you look at the foundations, quite often that is the most sophisticated, work. And so I'm very interested in looking at that. I love Turkish food and, you know, on and on. It'll be a great adventure and it'll be a wonderful honor to be with both, with these two gentlemen, and visit this, you know, this really earth-shattering site. And I really encourage anyone interested in ancient archaeology to come and join us.
Thank you, Brien. Brien, I know you're focused on this research into this 10,000 BC era. They're building this monument at a time. It's close to the Ice Age, Brien. Have you any theories on that, why that is? Because of the band of the Earth that it's on, it's maybe free of the Ice Age? Or?
Well, I don't honestly know about how much of the Ice Age affected that area specifically, but it's a very historically intriguing area, because you do have the stories of the pre-Greek Some would say they are legends. Some would say they were real. The Titans. It'd be interesting to know if the Titans were actually an ancient race of people, or whether they're sheer, you know, fictional legend. But again, that whole area, really hasn't been looked at that much, I don't think, by the general public, especially, you know, people go to visit, you know, Greek ruins, etc., in Turkey. But now that Gobekli Tepe has been shown to be of the vintage that it is, how much more is in that area of the same age or even older?
For sure. Coming on to you, Andrew, I think one big question is the fact that all these spirals or circles that encompasses Gobekli Tepe, I think there's 20 of them, they're all buried. But I believe they were deliberately buried to, quote, protect them somehow, or?
Yeah, I mean, they were definitely deliberately buried, but there is a bit of a misconception that the whole lot was buried at the end of Gobekli Tepe's useful life. They weren't. They were buried in stages. Wow. It was almost like, you know, when one temple was, you know, had served its useful life, as it were, it was decommissioned, killed, ritually killed, in the same way that you would snap the end off a spear to release the spirit. The same thing would actually happen at Gobekli Tepe. That seems to be what was going on. And it's almost like, I mean, Hindu temples, for instance, you know, if they go out of use, they have to be properly decommissioned, you know, otherwise the spirit of the place will cause havoc in the local communities. And I think something similar was going on at Gobekli Tepe. These temples were so powerful, you know, that the spirits, the energies that were there, that one had to be closed down properly before the next one could be opened and used in that way. And this went on for 1,500 years. So, as I said, you've probably got at least 20 different temples beneath that mound, of which at the moment we're only looking at maybe half a dozen of them. And all the rest, we've just got no idea what's actually there. But going back to the point mentioned earlier about, you know, some kind of cataclysm or event, really, or, you know, why, you know, things would have been going on at the end of the last ice age, is the fact that around 10,900 BC, it's now pretty well established within science that there was some kind of comet impact event that devastated the world. A terrifying event and a very, very bad day in Earth's history that would seem to have affected virtually every continent of the world, most particularly the American continent that seems to have suffered the worst impacts and wildfires and events that were going on. But there's evidence of activity all over the world. There's a thick 3-inch or 8-centimeter layer of ash and other fire debris that's been discovered in everywhere from Europe to Egypt to Russia to Australia, which is all at exactly the same level in geological history, around 10,900 BC. And this comes right at the beginning of a mini ice age known as the Younger Dryas event, which began around this time and carried on to around 9,600 BC. Now, then the weather got better, the temperature rose again, and everything was happy and blissful. And that's when Gobekli Tepe was constructed, right at the end of this so-called Younger Dryas event, this mini ice age. And that's no coincidence. I'm sure of this. Yeah, you know, there's a relationship. And, you know, the evidence that I've uncovered would seem to suggest that Gobekli Tepe was constructed as a response to these bad things that were going on in the world, very much as if by constructing it, they believed that the shamans could in some way prevent further events like this actually taking place. And there are a number of legends around the world that actually talk about this cataclysm, a time of fire and flood and darkness and ice. And in various of them, those who are responsible are the race that existed prior to that time. Obviously, in biblical tradition, it's the pre-flood people, you know, the people of Cain or whatever. Obviously, in the story of Atlantis, it's the Atlantean all the way around the world. And there is a huge, great cataclysm. A few people survive, you know, maybe a male and a female, like Adam and Eve or whatever it is. And they repopulate the world, or Noah, obviously, in biblical tradition. But a number of the accounts actually talk about temples being constructed at that time to appease the gods, to make sure these things never happen again. Do you know what I mean? And it seems as if something similar was going on at Gobekli Tepe. And that one of the reasons why the shamans needed access to the sky world in such an immediate and grandiose manner was to try and ensure that these bad things never happened again. And I am positive that the art there, the design, the grandeur of Gobekli Tepe is not simply, you know, to impress. It's about regaining control, cosmic control, to ensure that another cataclysm never takes place in the world.
Wow, fascinating, Andrew, fascinating. Just on the fact that it's buried, I mean, so we're saying that they're most likely buried for posterity, but I think they were buried with a special type of sand. Did I read that somewhere?
No, there's no special sand involved. I mean, basically what they used was earth, which had been brought from the bottom of the mountain, so obviously in the valleys below, the plains below, but also refuge matter, you know, obviously what was created through people being up there so often. They used that, they chucked it in, animal remains, human remains, just anything that they didn't want. Wow. They filled them in. And it was a decommissioning process. I don't think that it was a case of burying them for posterity. I think it was really a case that they believed that at the end of their useful life, these monuments had to be correctly covered over. Mm-hmm. And quite clearly, by the time you reach 8000 BC, there were different things going on in the world. I mean, if there was some fear of cataclysms by that time, they'd alleviated enough for people to think, well, look, we don't really need to be doing this anymore. Let's move on. Let's start some fresh traditions. And also they had other things to think about now. I mean, now people were farmers. They had farms, you know, agricultural communities. People were starting to live in towns and even, you know, the first cities like Çatalhöyük in southern central Turkey, which sprang up around 7500 BC. And, you know, things were changing now. I mean, the emphasis on preventing some kind of cataclysm which had taken place thousands of years ago no longer was there. But the other important thing to point out about this so-called Younger Dryas impact event is that it wasn't something that happened in a single day. You know, that there wasn't just a whole load of impacts and it was all over in a few weeks. It would seem as if there were wildfires and other bad things going on in the world for several hundred years after this event. Indeed, it goes all the way through until about 10,340 BC, when there's another spike of activity, which scientists believe could even be another comet impact at that time. So you can sense that the fear within the period that would follow this, the fear that every time a comet appears in the sky, is this going to cause another cataclysm? It's actually a term. I mean, the visionary and writer Barbara Han Clow wrote a book called Catastrophobia, mm-hmm. which was about the idea that people lived in fear that a cataclysm would occur again, you know, i.e. because one had already occurred. And I love that term, and I use that a lot in the book, because I believe that the people involved with the construction of Gobekli Tepe were suffering from this condition called catastrophobia, you know, and that they really were worried that something like this would, you know, destroy the world completely next time.
Wow, totally fascinating, fascinating. You know, I wonder, Andrew, if they, let's say, hypothetically speaking, I might be a bit off, but if each one of these circular enclosures was buried every 100 years, would that be due to maybe an astronomical alignment being out of phase, therefore...
I think the main alignments are probably via the twin central pillars in the middle of the enclosures, and they seem to be aligned specifically to stars. I say it's Deneb and Cygnus, as say other people are looking at other possible stars as well. And quite clearly, with the effects of precession, you know, the slow wobble of the Earth over a period of 26,000 years, stars go out of kilter a matter of 1 degree every 72 years. So quite clearly, 72 years after your alignment, you know, the star's already almost beginning to misalign. And give it 100 years or 150, it would be totally useless. And I think there is a possibility that they did actually try and twist the into a new position, because in the largest temples, they're not the stones are not stuck within some kind of mortar floor or deep down into the ground like megaliths are in Europe, but they're actually set within these pedestals carved out of the bedrock, only about 6 or 8 inches deep, which in all honesty would mean that if these great pillars were pushed, they could even topple over. So clearly they had some kind of supporting frame around them, just as they are today, you know, now that they've been uncovered and restored, they have like this wooden frame around them. And I think it's possible that they did this deliberately so that they could actually shift the stones slightly to follow the setting or indeed rising of any particular star. But of course, even then, eventually the star will go far too much out of kilter and they would then require another temple to take its place. So I think that's what I think exactly what was going on there with regards to these large monoliths in the different enclosures there.
Wow, I definitely think you're right, Andrew. I think, you know, the sheer quantity of 20 would, you know, make sense if there was a decommissioning process over 2,000 years, because precession is
exactly
the key. Precession is the key. And I know you've looked into precession in the past, Andrew. Interesting angle on that. Have you looked into this, the idea of the T-shaped pillars in Menorca? Is there any, I know there's a massive gap of God knows many thousand years, 9,000 years, 8,000 years?
Yeah, I mean, there is quite a large gap. It's one of the things that kind of compelled Graham Hancock when he actually visited Gobekli Tepe. I've got a little video of him talking about that because, yeah, they look quite similar. You know, there's no doubt about that. But the ones in Menorca have a separate top. They're kind of balancing on top, whereas the ones at Gobekli Tepe are clearly one piece of rock, precision carved, to make it look like the top's like a separate piece. Although it's not, it's actually the same piece. So the sort of detail of Gobekli Tepe, probably many thousands of years older than the ones in Menorca, is much better, you know, in Gobekli. So, yeah, you can see similarities there, yeah. And I'm planning actually on going to Menorca in the next few, hopefully in the next few months, just to take a look and look at all the other sites there, because it's certainly, you know, an area of investigation that's certainly worth looking at. And it does make you question, was that influence? Was there a Mediterranean influence from Gobekli Tepe and other places? I mean, we do know Malta, for instance, is a very, very ancient, very ancient sites, temples there, and has underground areas like you get, you know, Turkey and Peru and other things. Even has the spiral carvings, which you get, obviously in Peru, but, and that's not as old as Gobekli Tepe, but there are resemblances to the sort of shapes of the temples, sort of, you know, ovoid or circular. But again, it's made of, you know, much softer limestone. It's much kind of, much more rough looking in various places. But so, yeah, you do have to question, you know, the influences there. I mean, it's just, honestly, now Gobekli Tepe is on the table. It's like everything else is the question marks are popping up. But yeah, I mean, it's certainly worth, worth checking out Menorca, even if it's just for a bit of sunshine.
Oh, for sure. Did you know we have T-shaped, megaliths at the top of Ireland, Hugh?
Yes, I've actually seen a couple of those. Yes,
not very far from me at all. If you ever want to check them out, you can.
Yeah, yeah. I saw a couple of pictures when I was in Newgrange Museum, and there was one that looked like it was just being transported from Gobekli Tepe and stuck in the ground next to these old dudes hanging out there with the sheep, yeah. And this old photo. And actually, what I think it was, correct me if I'm wrong here, James, is that the top bit of the cross had just fallen off or something, and it was left like a T-shape. But are there, what you're saying, this genuine T-shaped kind of hill?
Well, they're actually on Tory Island, which is off the coast of Donegal. It's a trek to get there, like. It's on the very northwest island off the northwest of Donegal. But, you know, I think they're carved from the One Piece, you know. They're definitely carved from the One Piece, like, in the shape of a T and stuck into the ground.
Okay, that's another area, because, you know, obviously the origins of Ireland are really in question. I mean, obviously Michael Sarrion's done some excellent research on that as well, but the ancientness of Ireland is, I think goes extremely far back, and I wonder if there are any connections there with places like Gobekli Tepe.
Sure. Yeah, well, I wonder if it was a Spanish connection, because they say that people in the northwest and the northeast of Ireland are genetically linked with the Spanish, like, you know, they've got the same blood group or haplogroup. You've been to Armenia as well, you haven't you?
No, we didn't. We were planning on going there last year, but it became very complicated and almost kind of political with the border issue there with Turkey. So we didn't have a chance to go to Karahund, which is this incredible stone circle site, again, astronomically aligned, again, very ancient, going back, I think, 7,000 or 8,000 years. But no, we didn't get a chance to go there, but I'm very, again, that's another place, as a pure megalithomaniac, I will be going to at some point.
Yeah, see, it's quite close, and that's why I asked you, it's quite close in age. Well, 7,000 BC, astronomically dated. So, you know, that's not far off the last building construction of Gobekli Tepe. I wonder, did they migrate?
It's probably worth asking Andrew next. I think he's done more research on the connections with Armenia and Turkey. So maybe Andrew, you could take up this one.
You're talking about Karahunj, right?
Karahunj, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. I mean, basically, Karahunj is a huge, great megalithic site of hundreds and hundreds of standing stones. Many of them, I mean, literally hundreds of them, have actually got holes within them, which have been verified as possibly pointing towards, you know, the midwinter sun or the midsummer sunrise, etc., etc. But some of them are definitely aligned towards the stars as well. And what they suggest is alignments towards Deneb, the brightest star of Cygnus, as early as 5,500 BC. And this is obviously very, very exciting, because obviously Armenia borders eastern Turkey. In fact, eastern Turkey in the past used to be a part of Armenia. And obviously you've got to start looking at the possibility if there's a relationship between the culture of Gobekli Tepe and that of Armenia. And also beyond Armenia in the Caucasus Mountains, in the West Caucasus, you've got literally 3,000 dolmens, huge megalithic structures like the chambered tombs of Europe. Many of them have these beautiful carvings of what appear to be like gateways or doorways around them. And they have like these stone, these apertures, these holes in the stones, you know, the facious stones that the which resemble the ones at Gobekli Tepe. And some people have suggested these dolmens in the Caucasus may well date back to, you know, 10,000-12,000 BC. I haven't seen the evidence of that, I must admit. I mean, conventional thinking for Karahunj and these dolmens is that they were constructed around 2,000-3,000 BC. But to be honest, you know, this is not exact science in the sense that, you know, that they found some artifacts there that they've dated to the Bronze Age. The structures themselves could easily date back much earlier. In fact, so little work has been done on these monuments in Armenia and the Caucasus that they really need to be looked at, as indeed do megalithic structures all the way around the world. I mean, I think this is what Graham Hancock, for instance, will be calling for in, you know, his book, Magicians of the Gods, when that comes out next year. that what he's saying is that Gobekli Tepe is your smoking gun because it was covered over, it's been preserved, you know, and the dating cannot be disputed. If the stones of Gobekli Tepe had been exposed to the air, the chances are other structures would have been built on the same site over the millennia, and you know, you would not have been able to get the same dating evidence out of it. In other words, you might have been able to look at the monoliths at Gobekli Tepe and suggest they were very old, but you might not be able to date them properly. And that's the problem with megalithic structures all the way around the world. You know, when exactly were they constructed? You know, when were the stones? I mean, many of the stones have been moved, for instance, you know, in other places. I mean, we just have no idea of exactly when megalithic architecture began. Well, certainly not before Gobekli Tepe. Now we know it began around 9,500, 9,600 BC, and arguably even earlier than that now. You know, arguably it could go back to the last ice age now.
Wow, thank you, Andrew. Fascinating. Yeah, Hugh, if you're going to go on a research trip to Armenia, let me know. I have a compass and I will travel.
Certainly. You're obviously a megalithomaniac, so you'll be the first to know.
Yeah, no, the thing that fascinates me totally about Armenia is that the angle that the holes are drilled through these stones, you know, you got a definite alignment there. You've got a definite direction, a definite angle. I don't think it's been done. I mean, somebody sent me a first edition of Paris Haruni's book, who mapped it out in, I think it was the 90s, and a guy from Armenia gave it. Yeah, there's not enough research being done there, so if you guys can get out there, you know, I know it's difficult to get in and out of Armenia, it's a nightmare. I don't think Turkey and Armenia talk to each other.
That is correct, yeah. I mean, that is certainly correct. And I think, like you just mentioned there, James, it's like the position of the stones. Obviously, you know, when you're dealing with megaliths, it's about, you know, luckily a lot of them stay in place. They're in their original position. I think that's one of the important things with Gobekli Tepe is that it was deliberately kind of, you know, before they buried it, it was reconstructed and put back into position of where it originally was. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people, I mean, obviously Andrew's looked into this and others, but I really feel they did that for a reason. And there's more, you know, more information is going to emerge from that. Obviously there's a lot of astronomical and solar and lunar, you know, activity that could be linked with it. And I find that with the towers, strangely, the towers you get in Peru, the chulpas at Silistani and Cotimbo, mm-hmm. I want to start looking at research of the way the sun and moon move around them. And they create certain shadows and they sort of, you can only see them really at certain times of day. Mm-hmm. They only sort of pop out. So I wonder if there's a code there, sort of some lost language that maybe that is still prevalent, is still at some of the sites in Peru, but could also be, you know, part of the sort of coding really at Gobekli Tepe.
Sure. Hugh, are you running the tour? Is the tour going through Megalithomania?
Yeah, it's going to be it's all on the Megalithomania website. It's also on andrewcollins.com. All the information's there, you can contact us through there as well if people have got questions. And it's organised by Travel the Unknown, a brilliant specialist tour company who we work with very closely, so that they kind of handle all the ins and outs as such.
Yeah, and there's still places left if people want to get in touch.
Yeah, there's some places left for sure. Yeah, yeah. To get in touch quickly though, because we're going to have to close it soon.
I guess just coming up to you, Brian, to finish off, I mean, some of these are, 50-ton megaliths? Let's talk megaliths, Brian, because you've been looking at megaliths for a while. You know, how much energy do you think, and how many people, or give me some, probably not even a number, but let's talk how much of an exercise it was to build Gobekli Tepe.
Well, actually, I honestly don't know where the quarry source is, but in the case of Peru and Bolivia, you know, you have, again, the conventional archaeological approach, which is that you had a slave class who found wooden rollers of some kind, like trees, and they were cutting these massive slabs out and dragging them across the landscape. You know, in the case of Tiwanaku and Pumapunku, which has been heavily plundered over the course of more than 500 years, there's only a small percentage of the actual stone left, but there is one that does weigh 131 tons. At Sacsayhuaman in just above Cusco, you have at least one stone, if not more, that weigh 125 tons. And these are measurements that have been done. These are not like wild guesses. So what we're looking at least in the case of Peru and Bolivia, and one may presume possibly the same thing going on in Turkey, is that you had people who had a capacity to comprehend the laws of physics in ways that we don't. I'm not stating that ancient aliens were involved in any way, shape, or form, but because so many of these ancient places clearly still have energetic properties today and may have had much more powerful energetic properties in the past, you know, that is what makes a place like Gobekli Tepe such a mystery and such a ground, you know, literally ground shattering new find, is that it's proving that sophisticated societies, at least in terms of being coordinated, existed, 10 to 12,000 years ago. And so that's why I'm very, very intrigued to go and visit it and see what has been uncovered. And as both Andrew and Hugh were saying, it's only a small percentage which has been actually excavated so far. So mm-hmm. How big could this site be? And what does it, what does it relate to in the area and possibly even farther afield? What does the symbolism represent? What are the star alignments, et cetera, represent? It's a very, very intriguing site, and I'm super looking forward to joining both Andrew and Hugh and our guests on this adventure.
Sure. Give us your website there, Brian, before we wrap it up.
Yeah, my website is hiddeninkatours.com.
Thank you, Brian. Just to come back to you, Andrew, to finish off, I guess. Can you imagine when this whole place is uncovered? I mean, how long are we going to take for that to happen, Andrew?
The problem is that the conventional thinking with archaeology today is that you do a little and leave the rest to the future, when the methodologies will be, much more technologically advanced, things like that. And unfortunately, we never will see exactly what is beneath Gobekli Tepe. I mean, excavations do continue there, but they have no intention of completely taking the top off the mound. And I think that that's, a travesty, really. I think that we really, really need to know what's beneath that place. But having said that, Gobekli Tepe isn't alone. I mean, there are many other places in southeast Turkey that could date back to a similar age and could even be as big as Gobekli Tepe, and they've not been investigated yet properly. And that's one of the areas that I'm working on now. I'm looking at new sites in southeast Turkey that have the same potential as Gobekli Tepe. But for the moment, that is basically the omphalos of the world, the oldest one. And, it's the source of everything. And I think people need to see and experience it.
I've never seen so many people excited about something in their lives. What did you think of the National Geographic article?
It was brilliant. I loved it. Yeah, I mean, you're getting so many of these articles. I mean, mainstream magazines, obviously documentaries, things like that, are covering Gobekli Tepe in a way which, gives it this foundation point of everything. It's not some left field idea that this is the beginning of the Neolithic revolution. It is now, and you have to accept that. I mean, it's not going to go away anytime soon, and you have to embrace it, which is why obviously myself and so many of my colleagues, Hugh and Brian and many others, Graham Hancock, Robert Schock, even Robert Bouval, are all looking at this now, because it's all a part of a bigger jigsaw that we need to understand to put the whole thing together.
Yeah, I agree. I quite like the National Geographic article. I think they've done a good job on it. And I think, it did a great service for the rest of the world to get their eyes on Gobekli Tepe. And I think we needed that, because it was lurking in the midst for a long time until that National Geographic article.
Yeah.
Did you see that bracelet, Andrew, that obsidian bracelet that was found nearby?
Well, Hugh and I were actually at the location where that was discovered last September. It's a place called Ashikli Hoyak. And, we made special arrangements to go there because of this discovery, and the fact that, I mean, this was one of the most sophisticated, advanced places of its age. I mean, it goes back to 8,000 BC. It was like a modern town, really, you know, complete with streets and things like that. And there was the manufacture of obsidian artifacts there, this most incredible bracelet with this precision, you know, design, which is like something that could only be created on a modern lathe, mm-hmm. you know, or from a modern mold or something like that, mm-hmm. which it was just extraordinary to look at. I mean, you know, look up a Sheikhli Hoyak bracelet on, you know, Google or whatever, and you'll see it. And this dates basically to between about 7,000 and 8,000 BC. And it shows the level of sophistication of this culture. A Sheikhli Hoyak is almost certainly part of the descendancy from Gobekli Tepe, which is not that real far away from there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the revolution had begun in civilization. And as I said, it all really can be traced back to Gobekli Tepe at this time.
Wow, yeah. I mean, for the listeners, obsidian is not the carver's choice of material, Andrew, is it?
Well, I think it's absolutely a crucial thing. I mean, it was seen in many parts of the world as embodying the fire of heaven itself. Mm. It also happens to be that one of the sharpest substances on earth, basically. It's used even today within the medical profession. And it was much prized by the peoples of the age of Gobekli Tepe and even much earlier than that. And whoever controlled the obsidian sources were very, very important people. And I think that this is a crucial point in coming to try and understand who it was that was involved with the construction at Gobekli Tepe, which is something that I bring out in detail within, you know, the Gobekli Tepe book that I've done. So, sure. But no, obsidian, incredible thing. It is my favourite mineral, essentially. Yeah.
That's one of my favorite artifacts in the world to look at, because I just think it's, that bracelet is so sophisticated, such a high technology to carve that, you know, at that time as well.
Absolutely.
Andrew, I wrote a paper on metallurgy before in my engineering days, and I covered Metsamore Foundry. Where does that fit into all this? Metsamore is like half a megalithic site and half ancient metallurgy going on there.
Yeah, well, this is a site, it's actually quite close, from what I understand, I've not been there, to Karahunj in Armenia. Mm-hmm. And what you've got here is evidence of smelting going back to probably about, well, they say 5,000 to 7,000 BC, and that's probably about right. However, it's certainly not the oldest. The oldest evidence of metallurgy comes from a place called Chayonu, which is only about, what, 50 miles away from Gobekli Tepe.
Wow.
I mean, that is where really metallurgy began. But of course, it spread out very quickly to places like Çatal Hoyak and Sheikhli Hoyak, and also obviously into Armenia. And also with it went this incredible ability of the artisans to carve stone, as you've said, stone and obsidian and things like this. It was part of this civilization of you know, of Southwest Asia that went out with the Neolithic Revolution. So, but that's, yeah, I mean, it's a site, you know, this site in Armenia, I won't even pronounce it because I can't remember exactly how to pronounce it. But, you know, this is part of this sort of wave of activity that seems to begin in Anatolia and move outwards.
Yeah. So fascinating when you look at Gobekli Tepe and what's around it, it looks like it's exploded from there and gone out in all directions.
It is. Yeah. I mean, as I said, there are other sites in the region. I mean, one that I've actually been to myself is a place called Karahan Tepe. That's probably about 50 miles to the east of Gobekli Tepe. And this is on a similar setting on a, you know, on a low mountain top with views at the horizon. And here you can see the stones actually sticking out of the ground. I mean, you know, just the heads of them. And there are flint tools everywhere. There's stone fragments, carved stone fragments all over the place. I mean, it's, you know, it's almost like a lost world, and it's miles and miles from the nearest road. And, you know, you just know that here, once they start proper excavations, they're going to find something similar to Gobekli Tepe. You know, so there was a whole culture doing this. It wasn't simply Gobekli Tepe itself, but that at the moment is our show home, if you like. That's the place that's being excavated. That's the place we know the most about at the moment. And that's where we have to keep our focus for the time being. But as I said, work is being done in other parts of southeast and eastern Anatolia at this time. And, you know, they also are uncovering incredible stuff as well.
Andrew, I thank you for your time today. AndrewCollins.com.
Yeah, it's my pleasure.
You're going to come back on and talk about your Gobekli Tepe book in May, I hope?
Oh, certainly. Absolutely.
I'd love that. Brien, I thank you for your time today as well.
Always a pleasure, James. Thank you.
And Hugh Newman, the website is
megalithomania.co.uk. Yes. And that's hughnewman.co.uk.
Listen, guys, I thank you all for your time today, and I wish you all the success on the tour. I'm looking forward to see what happens as well.
Absolute pleasure.
Yep, thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, James. Appreciate it.
This is your host, James Swagger, signing off. Don't forget to check out the full MP3 archive at capricornmembers.com. You can subscribe there and follow all the links for the show on capricornradio.com.